Hey there, welcome to Play Noggin. I'm Julian, your Brains Player 2. It's hard to believe the first Bioshock game came out over 10 years ago. Back then, I remembered how excited I was to learn the game's intriguing story, go toe to lead-weighted toe against Big Daddies, and try out plasmids in the game's fast-paced and brutal combat. But looking back on it now, the thing I really remember most fondly was the setting. The magnificent underwater dystopia of Rapture. Seeing an entire city of glorious Art Deco architecture anchored to the bottom of the ocean really sticks in your brain. And ever since my first playthrough, I've been dreaming about what an underwater city would be like. Then I grew up and realized it would be a total nightmare, even before the splicers showed up. I know it's been 10 years, but would you kindly indulge me? There's a very good reason there's never been an underwater city. Not intentionally, anyway. There are instances of cities being submerged when a dam was built or after a dam broke. Apparently, dams and cities don't mix. Damn. But no one has looked at a patch of ocean floor and said, yes, this is the perfect place for a thriving metropolis. Begin construction immediately. But let's go along with Bioshock's Andrew Ryan and his reasoning that the city had to be built underwater to keep it away from the prying hands of government. What are the challenges an underwater city would have to overcome? Well, the first and most obvious is all that water. Humans, last time I checked, breathe air, not water, so any building underwater would have to be airtight. Any leaks would be catastrophic, and keeping the water out gets harder the farther down you go. You probably don't notice it, but on Earth's surface, we're under pressure, pushing down on me, pressing down on you. No man asked for it, but it's there. It's all the weight of the air molecules above you being pulled down by Earth's gravity. And at sea level, the amount of force those air molecules put on you is about 101,000 newtons per square meter, or 14.7 pounds of pressure on every square inch of your body. To make comparisons easier, we can just call that amount of pressure one atmosphere. When you descend down to Rapture, the atmosphere gets heavy pretty quick, and I mean that literally and metaphorically. Every 9.8 meters you go underwater adds an atmosphere of pressure, because water is much heavier than air. Bioshock had the courtesy to give us the exact coordinates of Rapture, 63 degrees 2 minutes north, 29 degrees 55 minutes west, right between Iceland and Greenland. At those coordinates, the seafloor is under over 2,000 meters of water. That's over 204 atmospheres of pressure, or nearly 3,000 pounds per square inch. Sure, a couple of research submarines can go that deep, but they have to be small and cramped. A better comparison would be the next closest thing we have to an underwater city, a nuclear submarine. The maximum operating depth of today's submarines is classified, but we know that Soviet-era nuclear submarines could dive up to 400 meters. Any more than that, and they'd get crushed like a soda can. And that's just one-fifth the depth and pressure Rapture would have to withstand on the sea floor. This would mean the buildings would have to be engineered to a frankly absurd degree. The steel walls of the deepest diving research submarines are up to 3 inches thick. That sounds doable at first. The very toughest steel I-beams I could find for a skyscraper here on land are almost that thick. But remember that the entire outside of the building has to be made of thick steel to withstand the pressure, not just the support beams that have to hold the weight of the building up. So when the whole skyscraper has to be made of thick steel, it gets exponentially more heavy and needs even stronger support beams. Pretty quickly, the building becomes impractical to make, and heaven forbid you want windows. To withstand pressures at the sea floor, James Cameron's Deep Sea Challenger had one acrylic window almost a foot thick wedged into the 2.5 inch thick steel sphere. The sphere is the perfect shape for a submersible because it withstands pressure evenly in all directions, and underwater, the pressure comes from all sides. If Challenger used a cylinder instead of a sphere, the walls would have to have been 3 times thicker. You'll notice all the buildings in Rapture use that sharp, hard-edged Art Deco style with big square windows. From an aesthetic standpoint, it's pretty and I love the style, but that's about the worst possible engineering choice. Big, flat, squared sides focus pressure at the corners, and over time they'll be weakened by fatigue. It's the same reason jetliners have rounded windows. One early jetliner, the de Havilland Comet, repeatedly crashed because cabin pressure caused fatigue at the plane's square windows faster than expected, until the whole structure would suddenly fail. One way to counteract the force of the water outside would be to pressurize the inside of the building. That would push against the interior like air in a balloon, helping to hold the structure up. In fact, humans have done exactly this in underwater research stations, pressurizing them to 2.5 atmospheres, about the same as the pressure in a can of Coke. In fact, because of that, if you're in one of these labs, you can shake up a soda can and open it, and soda won't shoot all over the place. But you can only pressurize the atmosphere so much before it has adverse effects on human physiology. When scuba divers go below 30 meters and the gases in their blood get compressed, oxygen can become toxic, and nitrogen can make people loopy, even without an atom addiction. Coincidentally, divers call the condition the rapture of the deep. Gee, it's almost like 2K knew that permanent human life underwater was a terrible idea. I think it's pretty clear that an underwater city is pretty much impossible, just in terms of building the dang thing. We haven't even touched on some crucial things necessary to maintain life down there, like a heat source. You don't have to get too far below the surface before the temperature drops to a chilly 4 degrees Celsius. Smartly, Rapture is on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, where geothermal activity can provide heat and electricity. The electricity could be used to separate hydrogen from oxygen in water molecules to produce clean air, which is a bit easier than having an artificial forest provide the oxygen because Rapture would need 8 trees for every person. It might be a good idea to have some plants, though, to grow food. Otherwise, Rapture would have to get deliveries or raid passing cargo ships until they started wising up and avoiding the frozen triangle, or, eventually, resorting to cannibalism. But considering they're trapped at a depth where light from the sun can't reach them, maybe the citizens of Rapture would start going mad anyway. Don't worry though, since everything's made of steel, the salty ocean will soon reduce the whole thing into a rust stain on the ocean floor within 150 years. Any way you look at it, Andrew Ryan's vision of a totally free, capitalist society beneath the waves was doomed to fail. Not just because of the ideology, but because of basic science. Well, Ryan, I hope making your big, stupid, ridiculous, expensive point was worth it. Hey, thanks for watching. Would you kindly subscribe for more episodes? We've covered BioShock Infinite before and how the game brilliantly explores parallel universes. Would you kindly give that a watch? And as always, would you kindly keep on playing?